Hi, this is Amrita Sukumar, and I'm bringing to you this podcast called Unsettling. Look around you. Everyone is trying to create their own story. Make a tiny change in someone's life by just following their passion, and in turn, inspiring the others to follow suit. This podcast brings to you stories of people who have defied the definition of settled set by the society and have created their own. They have found happiness in their version of settling.
What is yours?
Today's guest and unsettler was asked to become an accountant, but instead she decided to hold people accountable about their lack of knowledge on disability access and have a dialogue with them. She's a stand-up comedian and believes in revolutionizing the comedy scene and changing the mindset of the people one joke at a time. Without waiting any longer, let me introduce today's guest, Shweta Mantri. Hi, Shweta. How are you?
Hello. Hi. I'm good. First of all, that accountant and accountable line, Can I use it in my stand-up? That's damn funny.
Please do. I thought over it yesterday and I'm like, oh, this sounds really nice, you know. Somebody wanted me to be an accountant, but I'm really holding people accountable.
I never thought about it that way, but good job for coming up with that. High five to you. And yes, I'm going to steal that.
Please do. Thank you for a very nice introduction. Actually, thank you for coming on the podcast. I'm so excited to talk to you about a lot of things, about your journey and what all you've been doing so far. Because we've had a conversation before this, and which the listeners don't know about. But it was very interesting. Is there anything new coming up in your life that we should look forward to? Any new jokes, anything new that you're coming up with?
See, that's what comics do. No? They go on stage with certain lines. Thinking that they're funny, thinking that they're going to be jokes that can make people laugh. But turns out they're not enough to make people laugh. So, there are premises, you know, the entire day you keep thinking about the things, you know, but you have to actually kind of to turn them into jokes. I think you'll have to sit down, do like a proper setup, punchline thing, try it out, you know, make variations, keep adding, improvising. So yeah, there are premises, and I'm not sure if I should talk about them right now. I don't even know, you know, how many of them will be taken on stage. But
Okay, so it's a secret. We'll look forward to it on stage.
Whenever, hopefully, one day, someday.
Yes, someday. Looking forward to it. So Shweta, let me dive in straight into the episode. How has your journey been so far?
I was born with something called a spina bifida that affects the spinal cord. I was operated when I was 4 months old, and then I eventually began walking with crutches and caliper when I was 5 to 6 years old. My parents enrolled me in a school for able children, that's what they call it. And I think looking back in hindsight, I grew up having to tackle a lot of physical and psychological barriers, as I'd like to call them. Physical barriers because obviously infrastructure, you know, so like I grew up in the 90s. To begin with, the school where I was studying, it's obviously a great school. But the school where I was studying, they had multiple wings, no? You have the school. So like the two wings on one floor had a washroom. So out of the 3 washrooms on one floor, only one washroom probably had a commode. So like we used to have a chair. That would help us do our business properly. By us, I mean there's one more physically challenged girl, disabled girl with me. There were two of us. And from facing physical barriers such as steps or, you know, the lack of an accessible washroom, I grew up in the 90s, so going to places or going to theaters, you know, those single theaters, single scene theaters like Rahul Mangala that didn't have a toilet. Not drinking water when I'm outside to sort of, you know, make it easier for me. To maybe to experiencing psychological barriers, because even though my parents, quote-unquote, gave me a normal childhood, and I hate to use the word normal, you know, it still came with a set of rules and limitations, you know, or like even at school, as I was in a school for able children. So... You know, the teachers saying that don't go on the ground in the lunch break, sit on your seat, sit in on the bench outside the classroom, mm-hmm. or even like wanting to go on the ground during PT sessions, you know, just to see what the other girls are doing, you know. No, you be in the class and do your homework, you know, stuff like that. Or like those nosy relatives saying, you know, no, or like, let's say going to family functions. I'm like, haan beta, tum yahi par baitho, tum kahi jao mat, tum ye mat karo, tum wo mat karo. And then going to college, all of this kind of just built up. And after my graduation, I went to SIMBI, a great campus. Mm-hmm. I did my MBA from there. There was this particular place, right. or there were these 2-3 places on the campus mm-hmm. where they forgot to build a ramp. So I asked them to build a ramp, and they're like, haan, karenge, karenge, karenge. And that eventually kind of got done like one night before the NAC committee came in for inspection and stuff. To give context to everybody and to you as well, so I walk with crutches, but the mm-hmm. campus was huge. So the university had given me a wheelchair to kind of maneuver around on the campus. And when I started to use the wheelchair, mm-hmm. you know, then I started, and those physical barriers became more real. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I mean, I always tell everybody that I feel like, although, I mean, this might be like a tricky statement to say, mm-hmm. but I still consider myself slightly lucky to be on crutches and still be able to kind of go to places, you know, and be able to climb steps even if it is with help. Mm-hmm. So being on the wheelchair kind of gave me a really, really honest and harsh perspective of what my other friends would go through. Right. In terms of accessibility. Then I went and got placed in Bombay for my job. And then I came back because I couldn't have managed myself in the Bombay monsoon with the given infrastructure.
Right.
And I kind of applied for jobs in Pune in the PR sector. But again, I had to give up because of infrastructure issues. Because half the places didn't have like an accessible toilet. You know, they were in commercial complexes where you'd have a common washroom which would be always be slippery and inaccessible.
Okay.
Or that the offices would be in spaces where there was no lift and mm-hmm. stuff like that. So it was a build up of things, and after I completed my MBA, I started working with a friend of mine on this initiative called Give Some Space, mm-hmm. where we raised awareness about the need of a barrier-free infrastructure, mm-hmm. an accessible infrastructure for people with disabilities. Where we also want to collaborated with a couple of organizations to build infrastructure on their That's campus right. or in premise. So okay. that happened, but then it didn't materialize because my friend moved out mm-hmm. of Pune. But since then, you know, it was just there in me that I want to do something about this. And I don't think I kind of started with the objective of wanting to do something for the disabled community as such. It was more sort of key to this, and I want to tackle this, and I want to address this stereotype, or I want people to stop looking at people with disabilities in a particular manner.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, that's how I started talking about disability and disability issues.
Right.
I mean, until a couple of years back, and even now, I also do content writing. Mm-hmm. That's how I managed to earn my little bit of bread and butter. It's since I completed my PG in 2010. Mm-hmm. No, since 2012, you can say it's just been me. It's just me using multiple platforms to talk about stuff that matters and initiating conversations that need to be had, you know. it's just trying to talk about things that people try to put under the carpet and ignore.
Yeah, that's true.
The stuff like that.
So,
and that has eventually led me to kind of to stand up on mm-hmm. disability. Yeah.
Okay. So it's been a long journey for you, and you've traversed so much. Like, I understand the kind of physical and psychological barriers that you had to go through personally. And as you said before, that you were a little angry about whatever And I'm glad that you pulled through all this. And I absolutely love the initiative Give Some Space. I like the name. I'm really sorry that it didn't go ahead and become something really big, because I mean, at least the name is really catchy. It would have caught
on. Yeah, it's a very catchy name.
Obviously, you have to give people some space and understand what is, you know, what are their problems.
Space. It's like reclaiming my space in the society, you know,
mm-hmm.
standing up for my space for myself and holding space for myself as a person with a disability.
You definitely told me before that you've done stand-up comedy and you have cracked jokes about disability, making people a lot uncomfortable, and trying to have a dialogue with them.
Yeah.
So how do you feel that, you know, the response has been of the people, or how do they react to it, and do they feel really, are they responding to it? Do they feel that they should also come in and work for Give Some Space or do something that will help you and others?
So, yeah, so as I mentioned to you earlier, I've been talking about disability because I want to. I did multiple things on a personal level to initiate dialogue and have people be a part of the conversation. I made this documentary where I covered issues on disability, and I went to NGOs, I spoke to NGOs, you know, I spoke to people working in the disability sector, I spoke to my friends, you know, who were getting married at that time, knowing their stance on dating a person with a disability or whatever. I went to places. I went to Good Luck Cafe, let's say, for example, to just show how inaccessible this place is. Although the food there is great, yummy, the pan masala is next level. But I covered these things, and then the feedback was okay.
Mm-hmm.
But there were some people who reached out to me and said that, oh my god, why are you using this harsh tone? And this is what I hate about people, you know, like they're like, oh my god, you know, this person reacted in so and so way, and this person has this approach, and this person always keeps talking about XYZ things. But I'm like, hey guys, why don't you just step back and think about what triggered that?
Yeah.
You know, it's always, I think we've been living in a society where you always tell the oppressed how to respond.
Yes.
But you don't change the way you respond or you interact with the oppressed to make them the not oppressed. Right. So at that point, I was like, okay, you know, I definitely want to continue to talk about this. So let me try multiple mediums. And if you tell me in 2015 that I will be doing stand-up comedy in 2021, I laugh.
Mm-hmm.
That would have been the biggest joke at that time. So I've always been this person who didn't hold herself back,
mm-hmm.
and who didn't pretend to be a happy person when mm-hmm. she was not. I always wore that as a badge of honor. I'm like, mm-hmm. I'm the most real person you can know. So, being that person at that time, I never thought that stand-up comedy would work for me. So, at some point in like 2016 or 2017, I did like my first stand-up gig with the objective. I think it was World Disability Day. I actually wanted a couple of friends of mine to kind of do some jokes on disability. Mm-hmm. But they're like, no, we can't do it because, you know, that will be punching down. I mean, the narrative that you want us to adapt,
mm-hmm.
we will not be able to kind of say that and own that on stage.
Right.
So I'm like, okay, I'll give it a shot.
Mm-hmm.
I gave it a shot. It was okay. It was like as any the usual first gig, you know, nothing really great. I wasn't the star who was willing to be born on stage. I did that during some portion of my set.
Right.
But then post that, I still kept trying my hand at stand-up comedy. And then there came a point where I started doing open mics regularly.
Mm-hmm.
And looking back, I feel like what kept me going is first of all, I think the validation, which obviously keeps every comic going.
That's
right?
True.
Just going on stage and getting the laughter and the applause. But I think more than that, for me, it was being able to say things on stage that I wouldn't in real life. Yeah. Normally do, right? Like, there's escalation on stage, right? You add stuff, you improvise stuff, you tackle things you can't, you address issues, you address those nosy uncle, aunties, relatives, you address the government, you know.
Yes,
you get to do all of that, you know. There's more freedom and liberty. I mean, as ironic as it may sound at this point in time in our ecosystem. But yeah, I mean, you can obviously explore more on stage. Yeah. And I think that just kept me going, you know, because in real life, somebody asks me questions about my disability, I have to be mindful of my response. Like, okay.
Exactly. Thank you, G. If there's some auntie, you cannot directly go and tell them, auntie, but then you can collectively address all the aunties in the world by just giving one joke on the stage.
And to answer your question about how people have been responding, that's what the question was, right?
Yeah.
So it's been a mixed bag, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
Some people are open to understanding and laughing at disability. The others probably take time to break down their barriers, mental barriers, and be comfortable, you know, because all the time you've been told, like, oh my God, you know, suppose you have a disability, you know, aise kar sakte ho, aise nahi karna chahiye, aise nahi hota hai, stuff like that.
Well, it's been a journey. I completely agree. So I would suggest people go and watch the documentary, because it will be definitely informative, as you've done a lot of research about it. So do watch it. You have put in that effort to research about what kind of disabilities are there and how it is to be made accessible to all. So of course that research is going to be fruitful for somebody who has absolutely zero knowledge about this, like zero, from ground zero if they're starting. It's going to help them at least reach that first step, metaphorically,
right?
So yeah, so hopefully that's
nice. Aww.
She's being so sarcastic. Oh my God.
I'm just conscious and awkward right now. Like, that's it. Like, I mean that's me all of my life, every breathing moment. Yeah. But I'm just slightly more conscious and awkward right now.
I just had one question. What do you think are the changes that should be there in terms of infrastructure or in terms of the dialogues that are to be there with the people? What do you think should be the changes in the foreseeable future?
I have this concept show called With Disability,
mm-hmm.
which is an hour of comedy and conversation. Mm-hmm. It's 20 minutes of comedy followed by conversation. And the conversation part again addresses stereotypes and attitudes and psychological barriers. And in that, I have a statement, where I say, it's kind of sad that someone like me is making money out of telling someone like you how to interact with people with disabilities, something as simple as and basic as that. So what I'm trying to say is, and this might sound very idealistic at this point. I don't know, but it's as basic as this. Okay, how about we reach a point where inclusion is not a second thought, right? Like, you see, every company has an inclusion and diversity wing, you know, and like, what is this? It's basically saying that there is one set of people that are the norm, and then there is the other, okay? And there are multiple others over here. So why not we not have others, and why not we have everybody and have an ecosystem for everybody that includes the needs or addresses the needs of everybody without having to label them as special. So I hate this term special needs. You know, I'm like, I don't have special needs, bro. I have needs. Okay, it's just that you are not conditioned to think that my needs are as normal as your needs.
So true.
Right.
So true. Huh. I mean, that point hit the head so bad. And in a very mellow way. I understand. I completely understand. If there were no barriers, if there were no basic barriers, like maybe ramps to access a building, or lifts to access other floors, or you know, the roads are good. Even if you're climbing now, at least there's BRT, so it's fine. Like, you can climb onto the bus very easily. If the basics have been taken care of, like the basic things, like the infrastructure has been taken care of, then there won't be any need to create an environment of inclusion. Like, you don't have to prove somebody that I'm including these portion of the society in my office or in my workplace or in whatever. You know, honestly, the only space that I have seen very beautifully designed is the school in KP. I have to use the term, it's for special children. And so
it's for people with disabilities, for children with disabilities.
With what disability? Sorry?
It's for children with disabilities.
It's for children with disabilities. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. So now I've learned something personally. I'm glad. So I went into the school, and what they did was, there's one garden. There's a garden there. So they asked us to blindfold ourselves and to walk through the garden. So every pathway had a different texture. Every time you were about to hit your head, there's a wind chime. So you can hear the wind chime, and then you know, oh, there's some barrier that is going to come. And then you can touch the space, and you know which area you're in, because you can touch the entire thing, and everything has some kind of texture, something changing. There's a noise when you're walking. There's a, you know, if you are going to a different corridor, there's a maybe tapping noise or something of the other that is happening. You know, there are changes or hierarchies happening. And when you walk through the wall, you know, for example, if there's a sandstone here, so maybe it's an arts and crafts classroom. Or if there's something else, some other texture, you know, that is the classroom. So it was so it is so beautifully designed that, I mean, I know that people who, even children who have some kind of disability, will be able to move freely through it. Like, there will be absolutely no issues. They know which, what is going where, and they are having a gala time. I mean, they're playing in the garden and nobody's there to supervise them. Like, it's so beautiful. So,
to the conversation that we were having, I just wanted to sort of make one point. I was doing my thesis during my MBA, and had gone to an architectural college to talk about the lack of barrier-free infrastructure. To begin with, the architectural college didn't have a ramp at the entrance, so but of course, this was 10 years back, so I'm hoping that there are some changes. So I spoke to one of the professors over there, and I was like, sir, at that time, the 2016 Act for People with Disabilities was not in existence. So it was the 1995 Act. So I'm like, sir, provisions kiye hue hai, sab hai, hai na? So why don't architects and builders provide for ramps and accessible infrastructure? And he's like, madam, mare aate hi kam log hai, ya to aate hi nahi hai, hum kyun banaye? Like, sir, aap banaoge nahi to aayenge.
To aayenge kaise? So true.
Hai na? So I think a part of, let's say, as much as, I guess, again, I don't like the word, but as a part of normalizing disability is to also give people with disabilities the opportunity to be outside. Because the more disabled people you see every day, the more okay you will feel, you know, the more less awkward you will be.
Yes.
Like, to give you a very small example, I have my nephew who stays in the US, okay? Who is 10 years old right now, but who keeps coming once in 2 years, all right? So this was, say, maybe 5 years back. He was here one summer. We chilled. We had a good time, okay? And he went back. And then I video called with him after 3 months. And I still don't know how children's brains work, right? And what is their memory like? And, like, say, he spent time with me for 2 weeks, but then maybe he's forgotten who I am or what I look like. But then we spoke on a video call, and then he very casually, randomly asked me, Deebu, where are your crutches? Okay. So this child remembers that I am his bua who has crutches. Right. And he said that statement so casually.
So casually.
Like, it's not a big deal. So good for him that now when he meets another person with a disability, he won't be awkward, right? So that's what I'm talking about, normalizing. Yeah. Like, the more different people you interact with, not just disability, but maybe LGBTQ, you know, as well, right? Yeah. The more okay, it will become
more open-minded. You would be rather,
I mean, or more inclusive also. I mean, as much as it is an afterthought.
As you said, that there's a psychological barrier because there's no dialogue. Since there is no dialogue, people don't know that there are different things happening. You are in the, if you are in the same environment for a very long time, you tend to behave the same way. Or that is how you learn new things. So once you break out of that barrier and you start conversing with other people, that is when you realize that, hey, this is normal. This is normal. This is okay. What do you suggest that everybody does to make sure that this change happens? Is there something that can be done? Do we write to somebody or is it possible? Because I would personally would love to do something.
I'm just going to repeat what I said.
Yeah.
You know, I strongly feel that mental psychological barriers lead to physical barriers.
Right.
You know, so for the physical design to change, your mental design should change.
But that's a long process. Right? That's a long process. I think hopefully we can just force people to get the design changed. If
it's
that is
long,
possible, then.
But it's going to be a sustainable process, which is going to, and the changes will stay for long. You know,
so you're saying that psychologically, if people change, only then the physical design will change, and that is how it's.
No, matlab dekho na, abhi like let's say for example, I was talking about Simbi, right? There was this one ramp in Simbi, which was which could qualify
as a
slide as well. Exactly. Yeah. Because qualify as a slide as well, and I have fallen down four times while going down that slope. So this is what I mean. People will still like if things
created
are
created for the sake of creating it.
People will still create it, but then is it accessible? You know, is it really helping? Is it really making that person with a disability do things independently?
That's
no.
True.
I mean, I would still have to have someone behind me on that ramp to ensure that my wheelchair doesn't skid.
Oh my God.
You know?
Got it. I understand that completely.
And there was one, again, there was one entry point where there was a ramp and the ramp existed after a step. In the same campus. Exactly. So you're actually picking, you're checking your checklist. You know?
Yeah, it's just, yeah, got
but
it.
It's really helpful. So yeah. I feel it needs to come from a more authentic space.
Yeah. So I understand that you cannot just force somebody to change the infrastructure. It should come from a place that's within and you know that this is something that is to be done.
You can force them, then you'll have someone like me fall down the slide five times.
Exactly. It's just, it'll just be for the sake of doing it, right? It will not be because you have to provide a proper slope. Or you have to follow rules and guidelines.
Accessibility comes from like a mindset change. Unless and until you feel for something, you feel the need for something, it will not manifest in the physical form.
So, what is that one thing that you learned from your experiences so far that you take along with you like a talisman? Like it's like a learning that you keep with you.
I'm sure that this might not be something that people would expect to listen. But here goes. So you know, when you're living with a disability, a lot of people around you. I mean, and I think it's almost everybody, and it's almost every time that people don't expect a lot out of you. Right? They're like, "Haan, bare minimum kar lo, types ho jayega." Right? Mm. You don't need to, you know, do this. You just do what's comfortable for you, right? And you're also told, on the other hand, that whatever you do will not be enough, you know, because you'll always be judged from that lens of a sympathy or inspiration or whatever. So I think what happened for me is I somehow became okay with doing the bare minimum, you know.
Got it.
I kind of also meant, I mean, right now I also mean professionally, and that kind of very subconsciously seep in into my comedy also, where I would expect to get a laugh like other comics, but I wouldn't. And then one fine day I realized, because I'm not working as hard as them, you know, you idiot, you're not doing what they're doing. you're not writing as much, or you're not watching as much, or you're not pushing yourself as much. So I'm trying to break that pattern where I myself don't become a victim of the stereotypes that I am trying to break. Yeah. I mean, the narrative around me became my own voice. Yeah. And I think I have come a long way. I mean, I still get into that pattern of doing the bare minimum. But then I'm like, no, if you have to be good, you have to put in equal effort. However, having said that, that does not mean that every disabled person should try to overcome their disability or you know, not acknowledge their limitations.
Coming to the final question, it's called, since you're on the Unsettling podcast and I encourage people to unsettle, I would like to ask people their own definition of settle. So what does being settled mean to you, Beta?
Beta ji.
Yes.
So I am 33. I recently moved out of my parents' house to stay alone. Not because I wanted to live in with somebody or because I wanted to enjoy any aspect of my life, but simply because I wanted to explore, how I can survive independently, or how I will even do emotionally when I'm staying alone. Mm-hmm. And I am feeling a bit settled. So, I mean, if you're asking me the definition of being settled or what settled means for me, it just means figuring out your own version of settled. You know, like I said earlier, everyone has their own version of normal, which should be accepted.
Right.
So, yeah, like everyone should have their own version of being settled. For me, settled means staying by myself and figuring out tools and hacks to stay alone without being over-dependent on somebody. Right. You know, and that gives me the satisfaction at the end of the day. I feel like I'm a happy person going to sleep because I'm in charge of my life and I'm accountable for my own actions. I think it's just finding your own space of happiness and comfort.
Yeah, that's settled.
That is settled.
That's true.
Settled with your own self, settled with your own expectations, with your own needs.
Yes.
And with your own quirks, I feel.
Well, thank you so much. That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
And thank you for having a dialogue about stand-up comedy, about disability, accessibility, whatever research you've been doing, sharing all this with me and the listeners. So,
thank you.
I would just like to ask you, is there any website or any place where people can get in touch with you, or you want to promote any, you know, anything that people can do and volunteer for? Is there something?
Please come for live shows whenever they happen.
People
who are in Pune, I also perform in Bombay whenever I get a chance to.
Bombay as well.
Yes. And my Instagram handle is imadmantri. imadmantri with a double I.
Yes.
And that's where I post some comedy content, some disability content, some real content, some human content. So I don't believe in sort of just portraying the happy side of things. So yeah, please follow me and let's interact and let's engage and let's have more dialogues.
Yes.
And
okay then, thank you so much for coming on my podcast. I will be adding other links in the description and people will have a lot of fun listening to this episode, I hope.
Yay, thank you so much for having me.
Hi, if you can hear this, that means you have reached the end of the episode. So like, share, subscribe, follow, stay tuned to Unsettling. And if you want to get in touch with me, you can always reach out to me on my Instagram page, AmritaSukumar_Unsettling, or send me an email on podcast.unsettling.as@gmail.com. Hope to hear from you soon. Bye.